It's time for Shake, Rattle, and Troll, a show for the serious fishermen, as well as the novice looking for tips from the pros. Shake, Rattle, and Troll is brought to you by Bill Luke Dodge Chrysler Jeep. Now, here's your host, saltwater fisherman and tournament pro, Don McDowell.
You are having a Craig Russell day?
We're having a tech problem.
Uh-oh. Hello.
Hello. Okay. All right. Hey, we're live. Woohoo!
I thought we were on life support for a second, yeah, folks. It didn't happen.
It was. KFNX. It's overcast. Nothing's working today.
That's all right. Hey, we all have technical malfunctions. Anyway.
No, I want to say that publicly. It was my fault something wasn't pushed, and I was in here listening to Rare Earth. I just want to celebrate an old Rolling Stones, and I didn't look at the board like I usually do, so that's my confession for Sunday morning. Have a great show. See you later. Bye.
Jennifer got too much sleep last night.
Wow.
I guess all right. Last week it was me. This week it's Jennifer.
Nice to hear. Anyway, we're going to move along. Hey, we got a lot of stuff to do today. JK's in the house, the president of the Arizona Deer Association.
Morning,
Don. Owner-operator of Safeguard Business Systems.
Yes.
And thank you for the bagels.
You're welcome.
Back from Louisiana, our local Ute champion, Taj White. Actually brought his dad back.
Again, he had to do that.
Hey, welcome back. We're going to talk about fishing in downtown Louisiana. A couple other things we're going to go through. There's been a lot of controversy over the criminal trespass fishing issue with Dean Cruiser and Steve Cherninsky. We're going to tell you what happened over there and what you're going to be allowed to do, not going to do. And
I think there's a term for that, much ado about nothing.
Exactly.
Yes, but it's, you know.
Unless I had a 30-foot boat that somebody was plinking hammer shad lures off of.
Oh, that would be a terrible thing to do to a hammer shad. Wow. Anyway, you know, getting back to your point, years and years and years ago when I started this, I was working with Rich Jones, Jones and Bates. He was making hand pours.
Mm-hmm.
And he was a hell of a fisherman. Did you ever meet him?
Yes.
Richie Jones? In fact, Jerry Tate's still driving Richie's Skeeter. I mean,
really?
Yeah, I think that was in 95. Great boat. Awesome little boat. Anyway, I asked Rich, why don't you fish tournaments? He says, I don't like the drama. And I did, at that time, I'm going, it's fishing. Drama? Really? Are you kidding me?
Fishermen. Drama.
They're hand in hand. In my life, have seen more drama over any sport than bass fishing.
It's worse than a bunch of women. It is.
We got them topped.
It is.
Yeah. Yeah. You take any tournament circuit, put them up against grandmas on a quilting bee. Grandma loses.
We're done.
See, hunting, you never have to worry about that. 30-06 is the great equalizer.
Don't even go down that road.
I can go there too.
No, you can't.
Let's go to a commission meeting
and let's discuss House Bill 2072. Are you kidding me?
You know that was what put me in flames over the years.
You think?
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Wait a minute.
We're all going into a
chat rooms, forums. KuzBlackTail.com, whatever you want to do.
Arizona,
I mean, that's where people who don't do anything go and sit and become their keyboard killers. And
exactly.
Don't get me on that.
It's very true.
Yeah, absolutely it is. But anyway, we're going to go down through that whole deal. Long and short of it, Cruiser, Cherninsky, found not guilty.
Outstanding.
You know, going into that, Dean would represent himself, and I've tried that personally. And
yours didn't work.
Well, Harry Craig back in the day was a leading attorney here locally, and I got, let's see what, I had done something, whatever it was.
You?
Yeah, imagine that.
No.
I was framed. And I decided not to pay Harry, so I went and represented myself. And he told me, he said, you know, I'm here on your appeal. And the great Percy, barrister that he was, said, "The man who represents himself represents
a fool for a client."
On the other hand, having said that, Cruiser did a good job. I mean,
That's impressive only because he didn't get carried away by the moment.
Clarence,
he didn't
Zero
let emotions Cruiser. Get in the way.
It's great. It's great that he did that. You know, he's pretty, he's a good spokesman for the fishing community, too. So,
however,
there was a lot of nervousness in the classroom, let's say.
No, I can imagine.
And the justice that presided over the matter was, he got it. I mean, he got the whole deal. I don't believe that the district attorney, assistant district or county attorney, I don't think he quite, I don't think he was prepared, I want to say.
Where was he from?
Globe.
Okay. Well, that makes
downtown,
all
that. Downtown Globe.
Okay.
And
my point's
Officer
made.
Officer Knudsen, I believe, needs to go back and take a boating refresher course.
I totally agree.
Yeah. So, anyway, we're going to talk about
that. Well,
that
was all politically very incorrect.
John, it is what it is.
Thank God. I know that.
If you're tasked with a public service, you better know what the rules are. You don't make up the rules as you go along. And that's been the problem over there. It's been a problem on a number of our lakes. These guys are out there enforcing stuff. That's not. Is there a rule? Yeah, it might be.
Don, we've talked about it before. Every national forest is its own little kingdom.
Well,
and they all make their own rules the way they want to.
Hopefully, by the end of the year, we will have sorted out the rules. The rules need to be unilateral.
You mean uniform?
Yeah.
Yeah, what she said.
Yeah.
Okay.
Cave Creek needs to be the same as Tonto. Tonto needs to be the same as Cave Creek. It's like, come on, really? Same thing with the TMR.
I know.
The whole deal. Anyway, I could do 3 days on that subject.
We both could. Hi, Taj.
Hello.
A lot of stuff going on over in San Diego. The dock count on the day and a half boats is just absolutely wonderful. 2 boats out, 41 anglers. They caught 205 yellowtail, 2 dorado. What's interesting here, no bluefin.
None.
Not yet.
No, they're gone.
Not anymore.
No, not anymore.
And they caught their average was 5.5 fish per stick. And the day single day dock count was 147 yellowtail, 4 bluefin, which means that's probably the tail end of them in fairly close.
Yeah.
2 dorado, they didn't average but about one fish per stick, 0.96. So day and a half trips.
Way to go.
Yeah. Having said that, looks like everybody caught a yellowtail.
And that's fun,
so
though.
That's all good. That's... And I want to throw a shout out to my son and my grandsons. They put a deer down yesterday up in the woods on archery season.
Which represents only 10 to 12% of those people who are out pursuing deer archery this year.
That's huge.
It's a good deal. So, moving along, how was your trip, Taj, back to Louisiana? How'd you do, buddy?
It was really good. It was really good, and I only finished 4th in the nation. I won my division in the whole Western division.
My man, right there.
Yeah. And
did you punch a lot of mats?
No, we didn't do
much
punching. We just flipped and...
Jigging?
No jigs, just all big worms.
Really?
And catching a little 13-inch fish.
You know what? It was great. Being able to watch him come up on stage with Hank Parker, and him being the only angler...
caught
a 5-fish limit out of both days. But Hank Parker was like, wow, look at this young man. He did not go for big fish. He went for numbers. He did the right thing. He's leading.
My man. Right?
He won his division. He was
game plan.
Leading the 11 to 14 age group day one and went in as number one seed for the championship day for his age group, which put him on boat number one. He was the first boat out of the gates with the older age group kid from Colorado. And they went out, and that lake was absolutely tough. I have never fished anything so tough. Water temps were in the high 80s, 89, 90 degrees.
Ooh.
The only reason why I caught that limit, there was cloud cover.
Yep, and that's was the big factor on Saturday was the cloud cover.
Well, I understand rumor has it you had some boat issues.
I did. We went out. I drug my boat all the way from Phoenix all the way to Shreveport and made it out there in 18 and a half hours. Perfect trip out. No problems. Thursday, first day out on the water, we hit boat lane. What was it? Boat lane D. You went boat lane D, hit boat lane A, made it about to the third, maybe the fourth piling, and sounded like a couple wrenches were playing tag in my lower unit. And I hit something. Honestly, didn't feel it too much. We ended up just stopping there, fished over across the lake, and he had a couple bites. It was tough. We ended up using a trolling motor to cross the main body of the lake, which took about an hour and a half.
Been there, done that.
And about, you know, I would say average depth from one end to the other was, you know, easily 6 foot. It's a real shallow lake.
Really?
That's not a lake.
Yeah. Oh, it is. Yeah, it's big. It is.
Was that part of a river system?
It is part of a river system. It is actually right on the border of Texas and Louisiana, and it's one of the, or it is the largest natural lake in Texas and or Louisiana.
It's not an impoundment?
No. Although the Corps of Engineers have dammed it up, it's a natural lake. It's a real shallow natural lake, and it is also the first lake that they ever did offshore drilling on, and there are still oil rigs pumping on this lake.
That'd be fascinating.
It is.
It's crazy. There's tons of them.
Everywhere.
Everywhere.
I like his thought process. It's crazy.
It was, you know, it was a really awesome experience for me. I know Taj.
How many kids did he have to compete with in your group?
How many? Around 48.
There were 48.
Really?
Yeah.
My man. All right, back with the champ. We're going to step down. Thanks to our sponsors. I'm Don McDowell.
John Kalizar.
Hey, and happy birthday.
Thank you, woo-hoo, sir.
Taj White.
And Murray White.
Happy birthday.
And Mac Patrick.
Happy
over
birthday
here.
To
hey,
you,
we'll,
big guy.
We'll be right back.
I know she don't love me. I know she ain't home. So finally.
All righty, we're back. Hey, over at Bill with Chrysler Jeep Dodge Ram is our private pre-Labor Day sale, John.
Hint, hint.
I'm just saying. You need
I'd
to
say
this.
I'm just saying. I know.
Yeah, you know, summer's winding down. It's coming to an end, and this weekend we'll feature some really hot deals. They're having a private pre-Labor Day sale. Never a better time over at Billow to look into buying a new vehicle. Employee pricing.
I'll tell you what. Yesterday,
oh,
I would
wait. There's more.
Okay.
Factory incentives. Zero financing.
Really?
0%. Yeah. And no payments for 90 days.
That'll take me right through my hunting seasons.
Yeah, but you won't have to drive the Prius. Think of it.
Yesterday, I will tell you, it was so sloppy up there.
Really?
You could not go anywhere without four-wheel drive.
Ooh.
Anywhere. It was that tough.
And where was that?
It was up south of Heber and Overgard to the east and to the west and all along the 300 road. Ooh. Blasting up bulls early in the early morning. And it was wet. It was raining. It was cold. It was pretty miserable.
That's
God, I
a good
had a great
thing.
Time.
I can't even comprehend cold right now.
Oh, I swear, I had chills. Yeah,
how did that cold. How did the Prius make it through that?
Prius is DOA at the moment.
It's being rehabilitated.
Yeah.
It's,
okay. Yeah.
Yes. Okay.
Major surgery.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It ain't going anywhere.
Well, I
there.
Just thought I'd let you know over at I-17 West Camelback Road.
God, I'm going to love those guys sooner or later.
Since
you know that.
1927.
Oh, yeah. I know.
All right, let's go back to Tosher. What was your plan going into day one? You know, we talked about all the things before you left, but, you know, between here and there, a lot of time has elapsed. You get there, and it's like, whoo, look at all those guys. Weird-looking lake. All right.
It was a weird-looking lake, and my game plan was to just go out, have fun, keep your head up, and just go and catch fish, and that was my game plan. Just
listen to this guy.
Yeah.
It's just,
wow.
I don't know how to explain it. It's just.
I get it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He went out.
Keep your head down and get in the game, man.
Grind it. Yeah,
our pre-fish was absolutely miserable. We had a local guy take us out for 2 days after my boat took a dump. And
well, let's finish up. What happened to the boat deal?
Oh, grenaded the lower unit.
What'd you do for a boat?
Actually, a buddy of mine on Facebook, his dad lives in Shreveport, and he offered to take us out. So he took us out for Saturday and Sunday, showed us how he fishes the lake, and he caught a few fish. I ended up catching one that day, and I caught one
nice
on Sunday.
Job.
It was brutal. That was some of the toughest fishing I've ever done.
Really?
Yeah, but Taj had a good time.
It was a great time. I mean, we got this lake is incredible. Cypress trees, the weeping willows.
Snakes. Did you see snakes?
No, we didn't see any snakes.
Neat.
Didn't
mice?
See any gators.
Any mice?
No. The only thing we saw were coons.
Yeah.
Raccoons, you know. We saw a family of those on the bank in Alligator Bayou, and, you know.
You got to love those coons.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Tell you what, that's the only way we used to hunt in Michigan back then. I mean, you get those big, big boar coons, and you're talking some serious fur.
Oh, yeah.
We love those things. Hey, a 35-pounder back in the late 70s would get you somewhere in the neighborhood of $150 back then.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. You don't take care of it properly.
Prime pelt.
About 135 stitches, too.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, like I said, pre-fish was tough. You know, it was kind of a Hail Mary.
God, fishing that shallow, was there any topwater bite?
None.
Really?
It was
none
very
whatsoever.
Very few and far between. You know, this lake is nothing like we have here. I've fished lily pads, you know, up in Idaho, but...
Oh, yeah.
They're the dollar pads. They're the small pads.
Mm-hmm.
These things were the size of frying pans. I mean, giant frying pans.
That's, princess.
I'm serious. Yeah,
that's the princess.
You can literally look out from the start of the pad for miles, and it's nothing but pads. And it's only 3 to 6 foot deep all underneath those pads. And unfortunately, we never had the Rice Krispies. That's what... it's a sound the fishermen look for when there's pads, and that's the bait fish and mm-hmm. the brim and the bluegill feeding on the bugs underneath the pads.
Sure.
Then that's so, where the bass up looking up at them, just doing their thing.
They just weren't there. Where'd you end up catching your fish?
Alligator Bayou. That's all we went all day.
Well, what were you throwing, Taj?
10-inch zoom. Worms, June bug color, and
curly tail.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ribbon and tail. Yeah.
My partner was throwing a black and blue jig.
How'd your partner do?
He only caught 3 fish.
And he was in the older age group.
Yeah, think he might have learned something from you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Ego always has a way of keeping guys out of the money, doesn't it?
I'll tell you what, bass fishing will keep your ego in check.
Absolutely, it will.
I'm telling you. Yeah.
His partner for day one, what an awesome kid. Kyler?
Yeah, Kyler.
He's now at Bethel University. He went straight from the tournament to college. This was his last year.
Don't tell me he's only 14.
No, he's 18.
Okay.
This was his last year in the youth. Awesome kid. He got an academic scholarship, and Bethel is supposedly one of the top-rated fishing schools in college. Recruited him from Wisconsin to go to school for business there because of his fishing abilities.
Wait a minute. There's a fishing school?
There's a fishing team, yes. College fishing is huge.
I know there's fishing. You said fishing school.
Well, they
teach you how to bass fish. I'm enrolling.
ASU.
ASU has a bass fishing team. No, these are teams. Not, it's one of the best bass fishing clubs in the nation for college.
Okay, I thought there was a curriculum. If there's a curriculum, I'm going. I'm signing up. I don't care. I'm going to learn.
It's called paying for guides. They help.
Yeah.
Come on, just give Jerry Tate a call.
Come on, Taj, talk to us.
Oh.
Did you help out Skyler or Kyler?
Yeah, I helped them out a little bit with my good luck charm and all that. I told them.
Oh, tell me what is your good luck charm?
A bag of Fritos.
Same bag? You take that same bag everywhere?
No.
Yep.
It's a new bag every day.
And just a new...
Same kind of Fritos.
Yeah, just same kind.
Thank you.
Yeah, I've got my New Orleans bass beads from the Bassmaster Classic.
There you go.
Lucky Charms. Yeah.
And Taj, did you catch all your fish off the front of the boat, or did you catch them when you were on the back of the boat when Kyler was up front?
Well, I caught them front and back.
So you kind of
equal opportunist slayer. Yeah, I love it.
And how many fish did you have before your older guy caught a fish?
I had my limit before he even had his
fish. Oh! Talk about pressure. I hate that.
Yeah.
Especially when it's individual weight.
There'd right, be a little bit of shakes going on if I were the older guy at that point.
He did.
Then I told my partner, hey, open your bag of Fritos and you'll catch a fish. What does he do? Open his bag of Fritos. Dunk, got one.
Nice.
Yeah. And just pulled stick three
just
fish.
Just think what would have happened if he'd had a box of Pop-Tarts.
Yes. He'd be in a sugar coma like you and I
right,
would be.
Right. Well, no, you know, quite frankly, John, Pop-Tarts are a universal food. Because first thing in the morning, you take him out of the...
This is his justification for junk food, but I love the creature.
Well, you call it breakfast.
Yes, you do.
Okay. The other thing that's in the bass boat is a little bottle of French's yellow mustard. If you put mustard on your top Pop-Tart...
You don't.
We call that lunch.
No, that's disgusting.
I'd rather stick to my Fritos.
Yeah, man. All righty, I think we're going to take a break.
Yeah, we need to.
After Jennifer's on. She had too much.
No more mustard.
And if you want to toast the Pop-Tart, right under the...
Oh, no. That's wrong.
That's without the wrapper, too.
You sing the Frito Bandito song, and you loco for crunchy Fritos corn chips. That's nice. Munch, Fritos corn chips.
Meanwhile,
back at the ranch,
back at I-17 West Camelback Road, John, here's the kind of stuff I'm talking about. 2500 Dodge crew cab,
yep.
Diesel 4x4,
MPGs.
MSRP $47,245. By the time you get all your $3,000 discount, there's a Bill Luke $7,258 discount, $36,987.
Wow,
that's
new,
doable.
New four-wheel drive. And
MPG, come on, talk to me.
Yeah, well, they've got the 1500s over there with the regular cab Hemi Express.
Yeah.
And when I say Hemi, they are an Express. It's got a MSRP of $25,845 on it, with all the discounts down to $18,987.
Wow.
Yeah, they like that 987 number, so.
I guess.
Yeah. Anyway, and.
That's ridiculously low.
If you're over there really want to have a blast, go drive the new Dodge Dart.
I'm not going to drive anything small ever again.
Back from the past, man.
Oh, just let me get in the Challenger just once.
Oh yeah, do it.
I used to drive one.
Those are
Taj.
Nice.
Let me ask you a question. What did you learn back there from those guys that we don't do out here? I've always found that interesting when you go to another region of the country. You pick up some new terms. And they've got a twist on a bait that you probably don't use, that's, you know, like bubblegum floating worms. Like, what?
Yeah, what'd you see? What did they show you?
They showed me just a lot of flipping techniques like we do up at Martinez and all that, throwing jigs.
All the same bait? Did anybody have a weird bait that was catching a lot of fish?
No. Everybody was mostly throwing jigs, shaky heads, and big worms. That's
what got me. We see out here shaky heads, you know, light line finesse fishing.
Right.
They're pitching shaky heads on 25-pound fluorocarbons, 55-pound braid, but they're throwing them the same places that, you know, we're, you know, throwing the jigs, we're throwing the big worms, we're flipping the beaver style baits.
What was the water clarity?
About 3 inches. It looked like black coffee.
Yeah.
It was. Okay, a really strong tea.
Yeah.
All right. See, this is it. Go ahead, Taj. Run them over.
Hey, do it.
Go ahead. Black tea.
Yeah, it looked like a really strong black tea. You know,
the water consistency was like that for the whole lake?
Whole lake.
Everywhere.
I wouldn't eat anything that came out of that lake. My life depended
on it. No, not really. Well, those boys, let me ask you this. How did you find... your reception from the local folks?
You know, it was actually really good. Once we got out of the first hotel we were staying in, that was a little sketchy. area we were at.
America's Best?
No, Super 8.
Ooh.
Yeah. It wasn't super and definitely wasn't worth $8.
Yeah.
So, no, you know, I would say 90% of the people were just absolutely, you know, friendly, Southern hospitality type. The other 10% wouldn't look at you, wouldn't talk to you.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Those are called Cajuns.
No, those weren't Cajuns. They were, they don't belong here. I'm not talking to him.
Yeah.
You know.
We have those here.
Right. I had the first day at the ramp? First day at the ramp, we went to check it out, and we talked to some locals, and, I mean, they brought out maps and showing us, you know, hey, check this out. The day the boat broke down, when I got to the truck, there was a little piece of paper wrapped up and stuck into my door handle. And I opened it up, and there was a bait. A little note said, here, try this. You know, no weight, three-aught hook.
We get those at Roosevelt. That's usually a parking infraction.
Right.
That or a hate note or a bomb.
Sure. Yeah. No, but, you know, I thought it was really cool. It was a green pumpkin red or watermelon red fluke. You know, and one of the local guys said, here, try this. Good luck. You know, 3-aught hook. And I was like, wow, that will not happen here. Will not happen here. You know, everybody's so hush-hush, keeps everything on a DL, you know.
I don't get it.
I don't either.
More drama.
Yeah, exactly. But that, you know, and that's generally how it was. What do you think?
Was anybody throwing pack of craws back there?
Yeah, there was people throwing pack of craws and all that, pack of chunks.
Green and orange ones.
He had a pack of chunk on his jig that on the day the boat broke, you were getting bites on.
Yep.
So.
Excuse me.
It's pocket chunks up here. He's still on this level.
Yeah.
So.
I got it.
All right, come on. He loves doing this to me, but I want to know what pocket junk is.
No, pocket chunk.
Oh. Doesn't matter.
We're
sitting
here having an edumacated discussion.
Right. Yeah, you are.
So we need to learn him a little bit.
Yeah.
That would be appropriate.
Give him some schooling, Taj.
What is a pack of junk?
It's just basically a little craw that you just...
Crawdad. Little what?
A little craw, like a crawdad.
You would know them
Thank
as
you.
A crayfish.
Yeah. Crawdad.
Yep. Yeah, in different colors. I was throwing watermelon candy and... That's pretty much it. It's just a
watermelon candy.
Yeah.
What is that?
It's just a
color.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
With
watermelon candy colored imitation crayfish.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
I
understand.
Trailer.
Thank you for involving me. I appreciate it. It's nice to be part of the show, guys.
No, you know, problem. We actually met the owner of NetBait.
Yeah.
He was really cool and was really impressed with Taj, knowing he was an honor roll student.
Not a problem there.
That was awesome. They had hats for sale and everything on the table. He goes, hey.
Got to meet all the pros and all that. David Dudley, me and him were best friends at that trip.
Nice.
Yeah.
That was cool. Tell him how we met David Dudley.
Well,
don't tell me it was at the bar, please, Taj.
No.
Okay.
Is that, what was it, date? It was day one
of pre-fish.
After pre-fish, David Dudley stopped at Subway after we just got done eating. And my dad says, hey, David, can we get an autograph with you? And he said, sure, and da-da-da-da-da. And we came over there, took a picture with him, and just talked and all that. And JT Kenny was there, but he didn't do anything.
He was in eating Chinese food,
yeah.
So. But when else did we see David?
What was it, day two?
Day one of the Forest Wood Cup.
Yeah,
remember?
Day one of the Forest Wood Cup. And we went down on the ramp one, and his boat, what was his boat number?
I don't remember what boat number he was. I think he was like 8 or 9, but literally
he
got
walked
out, of,
out
his
of his boat and
to
said,
come talk to him.
Nice.
Hey, how was your tournament? And he said, oh, my tournament isn't till tomorrow, and... Just chit-chatted again.
David Dudley was just a genuine gentleman.
You know, most of those guys are. You know, they're like any sport, you get the...
prima donnas?
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Get the Eagles.
Yeah.
You know, I kind of liken it like NASCAR, you know, when...
exactly.
Let's say Kevin Harvick was coming up.
Right.
You know what? The kid could wheel a race car, But his ego was so big that the other guys, they just kept putting him in the fence, in the fence, in the fence, in the fence, in the fence.
You got to put that on check.
And after a while, you're like, okay.
Why am I in the fence every Sunday?
Well, one of the guys, Dennis Curry. You know Dennis. Mm-hmm. Love Dennis. And he is such a chest pounder before the tournament that, you know, I'm going to do this and I'm on that. Da, 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 da. I'm telling you, don't do that. The fish god will slap you.
Yep.
I totally believe in the hunting and fishing gods. Absolutely. You do not want to cross those wires.
When you do that, you come back to the ramp, load your boat.
Go home.
Put your tail between your legs, get in the truck, out of here.
Exactly.
Come back and do it next time. Same thing happens.
You know, I do believe the fishing gods were listening to him last year at the tournament that you guys sponsored at Roosevelt that he won. When we were driving home, he's like, you know what? I'm going to make it to Nationals this year.
Nice.
And he did. And
you got to have a goal.
He wasn't cocky about it. He just, you know, it was just really cool. And he's like, I'm going to go to Nationals this year. And
Only finished fourth
in the nation.
Not bad. Yeah. Not bad. Particularly when you tell everybody you're from Arizona.
Exactly.
Oh, it's my like, God. Do you know how to fish out there?
You would not believe how many people back there believe that we have no water.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They think we're just a desert.
You know what? If you look at the Elite 50 and all the major circuits, Bassmaster excluded, but we have some of the best fishermen on the planet are trained out here in
Absolutely.
The West.
I mean, you know,
the concept is that we have no water, we have no boats, and what are you doing here?
Yeah, exactly. We still have covered wagons playing cowboys and Indians.
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah.
You know, you try to explain to those people from Louisiana.
I'm sorry, cowboys and indigenous.
There you go.
Species.
Native Americans.
Yes.
The people in Louisiana absolutely do not know we have pine trees.
Yeah.
We don't,
oh, no.
They don't think we have a forest. They think we're, from, you know, Utah to Mexico is just desert.
Snakes and cactus.
Absolutely.
That's all we have.
So, yeah.
Yeah, if it's any consolation, Taj, my sons, when they were young playing hockey, they were pretty good, and we only had like two rinks here in Arizona, but they had good players.
Yeah.
And they wound up going to Nationals as well. Mm-hmm. And the first night in, they go, Phoenix?
Yeah.
Are you guys here for the soccer tournament? No, we're here for hockey. Then we beat their team. Really ticked them off.
Yep.
Yeah, they're still doing that with the Coyotes.
Oh, I know that.
Yeah. All right. Hey, we're going to thank some of our sponsors. Take a little bit of a break when we come back. We have the dubious task of two soldiers on roll call this week. I'm Don McDowell.
Murray White.
Taj White.
The champ.
George Strait.
Oh,
all right.
Okay,
we'll be right back.
Deep.
All righty, we're back visiting with our youth champion. I'll tell you what, I can't be more proud of you. You know, you're
way to represent, man.
Honor roll student, good fisherman, good sport. Sounds like you've got your head in the game. What are your long-term goals for yourself? Let's say out of high school, getting ready to go to college. What do you want to do?
I just want to be a professional fisherman. I wanted to be in the Air Force, but I pretty much doubt that because I'm going to be too tall.
What?
I'm pretty tall right now for 12.
Oh, that's true. You can't be over 5'8", I think it is.
Something
in
like
the Air
that
Force.
To be a pilot.
Yeah.
Because those cockpits are way too small. But I just want to be a professional fisherman and go fishing the big boys.
Okay.
Nice.
Backup plan?
Think
about it. You got lots of time.
Oh, yeah.
You don't have to worry.
Yeah.
Just have a backup plan.
He's chasing the dream, man. You got to stay on it.
I understand that, but you also have to be pragmatic.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
Voice of moderation and reason here.
Well, there's a lot to be in a professional fisherman. Academics and your education and is a must.
No, if you don't have
You know, I guarantee you, the smarter you are and the more book work you do,
absolutely,
the luckier you're going to be fishing.
Business management. Marketing, math.
Absolutely. The marketing is key, especially in this business.
Oh, man.
I can just see somebody sitting around a table 25 years from now going, I fished with Taj, man. It was so cool. He was sitting there. He came out of Subway and he autographed my photo.
Cool.
See?
Think about
that.
That's going to happen. You know?
And always remember how you like the guys who are really cool to you. And you didn't want to be around guys who were like, don't bother me, kid.
Yeah.
Remember that.
You know, we did the expo, and we went and walked around the expo Sunday before the final day weigh-in of the cup. And he got to meet, I mean, some of the elite FLW anglers. He sat with Scott Martin in the Okuma booth for half hour, 45 minutes.
Nice.
Just sitting there BSing with Scott and looking at his rods. He was asking him questions. It was really cool.
He also wants me to be on the Okuma team.
Yeah, he's going to try to get Taj hooked up with Okuma. Well, y'all see his hat. He's wearing Logic Lures. This is a fairly new company coming out of southern Texas down around Corpus Christi. And they grabbed Taj and literally gave him sponsorship on the spot.
Nice.
Out of nowhere. I was like, oh, whoa.
Hello.
Yeah, you didn't have to sign anything, did you, Taj?
Not yet.
Okay.
Not yet. So, no, it's pretty cool.
Yeah, there's a lot to it. You know, you look at across the country, there are so many good anglers.
Yeah.
That don't make it.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to have the skills, the people skills, the social skills, the media skills. You know, right now we're in a kind of a unique place. We've never had social media before.
It's scary to me because the things that you and I did when we were younger, if we did that now, we'd be in trouble.
Serious trouble.
Yeah.
I have to do business with people that don't know how to take a photograph and email it.
How do you do that?
Really?
No, know what? If it wasn't for my smartphone, I wouldn't be able to know how to do that.
I know it. Well, you know,
I don't know how to plug my camera in.
We're using smartphone technology for everything. Uh-huh. I mean, we're moving.
Absolutely.
You know, I look at the generational differences. My parents, you know, bless their hearts, are probably both listening this morning because they do that. They don't know how to open their iPad to view the photos and go from one email to the next.
Yeah.
And we have to coach them a lot on that. On the comparative basis for what we're doing, where we're sending pictures, we're taking pictures, we're sending it to email and then blowing them up and working on Photoshop and then cleaning them up and sending them back out. That's a whole different world. Imagine what we're going to be. And this is only in the last 20 years that this has occurred. What do you think the next technology is going to be within the next 20 or the next 30 years? The differential, the quantum leap is going to be astounding.
It's going to go crazy.
No, I'm not going to have to worry about that.
Yes, you will. You and I will be worried. We're going to be doing races down the hallway with our walkers. You know that.
Yeah, yeah, dude. If we're lucky.
I'll be in the senior circuit. He'll be in the junior one.
Yeah, whatever. Yeah. All right, what's your next big event coming up? What are you fishing next year? Because next year is here, starting about October.
My next big event is our next tournament that we're going to be doing.
Next juniors tournament, which is September 15th at Roosevelt.
Nice.
Day after the All-Star Championship. We're also going to be doing a boat wipe down for donations, help the club out. So
what's the prognosis on the hot rod? The lower unit.
It is at Cabela's right now. Parts are ordered, and Allstate is cutting a check.
Are you driving a Ranger?
Nope, Skeeter.
Skeeter, okay.
Nope, they do Yamaha work there, and they've done really good work on a lot of Yamahas, so that was my first choice.
Yeah, Don McBride's struggling. He's got a down lower unit, got a couple championships coming up.
Yep.
Insurance company's going, no. Yamaha's going, nah, I don't think so. So, I mean,
right. He's
looking at a pretty big bill to get that
right.
250 HPDI running.
Well, you know, I got to kind of count my blessings. It was an impact. Otherwise, you know, it may not have been an insurance claim.
And you said you didn't feel it?
It wasn't bad. I felt something. Bonk. But I don't know, you know, if that was, you know, what we hit. And, you know, then it ran for a while. And then
a lot of stumps back there on that lake?
Lots of stumps.
No thanks.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And what's...
Anybody running blow boats back there with the pumps?
No. Nope.
Really?
They've got those... Learning time.
Thank you.
Okay. They take a conventional outboard, the power head, and the shaft, and they put an impeller, take off the lower unit, and put on an impeller. Sucks water in, spins it around with the turbine... spits it out. It's like a jet.
It's a jet drive.
Okay, so you don't, you're not run on a prop then?
No. No, you're sucking in water and spitting it out. It's yeah, a jet drive.
I like that thought.
Yeah. They do that a lot on some of the rivers.
So you have
the
to.
Shallower rivers.
Yeah, I mean, running over, that's like asking me to drive 100 miles an hour down the expressway and not know what's coming up, you know, within 2 feet of my clearance.
Exactly.
Not happening. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Are those ones?
Yeah, yeah. Who was fishing the classic down on the Louisiana, on the Delta, was driving an aluminum jet drive? Is that Rick Lund?
No, I'm not real sure. We did see one of the guys on a cup go out in a aluminum with a jet drive. Can't remember who that was.
Stump jumpers.
Yeah. No, but I don't remember on a classic who that was. I know Yellis was.
I don't know. One of the big boys on a major tournament. You know, I thought it was really cool. Thinking outside the box, got but way back in the slough.
Yep.
Caught fish. The water went down. Couldn't get out.
Yep.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. I remember that.
Sometime you can trick yourself. All right, folks, we're going to roll into a roll call for August 25th. We have two soldiers to honor today. The first is Army First Lieutenant Timothy G. Santos, Jr. Died August 18th, serving during Operation Enduring Freedom. 29 years old, of Helena, Alabama. Was assigned to the 4th Battalion, 501st Aviation Regiment, 1st Armored Division out of Fort Bliss, Texas. He died on August 18th at Fort Bliss from a non-combat illness diagnosed on March 24th in Kuwait City, Kuwait.
Army Master Sergeant George A. Banner, Jr. died August 20th, 2013, serving during Operation Enduring Freedom. He was 37 years old, of Orange, Virginia, assigned to the 3rd Battalion, 3rd Special Forces Group, Fort Bragg, North Carolina. Died of injuries caused by small arms fire in Wardak Province, Afghanistan.
That's the price for freedom this week. As always, the thoughts and prayers go out to them and their families in their units. Got a price tag. We'll be right back.
Shake, Rattle, and Troll, a show for the serious fisherman, as well as the novice looking for tips from the pros. Shake, Rattle, and Troll is brought to you by Bill Luke Dodge Chrysler Jeep. Now, here's your host, saltwater fisherman and tournament pro, Don McDowell.
Yeah, man. Hey, I'm Don McDowell. Welcome to the second hour of the Rainy Day edition of Shake, Rattle, and Troll. In-house with us, we have the changing of the guard in the White family. Murray White used to be in the limelight. Still could be, but
I haven't stepped out yet.
Not yet, but you see that white stuff?
Yeah,
in your
I know.
Beard?
Yeah.
Step aside, big boy.
Uh huh.
Well, here's the deal. It's all good. In my family, my son, my two grandsons are now hunting, and I've been reduced to a camp cook and a guide.
We call that something else, but I can't say that on radio.
No, I understand that.
rhymes with itch.
Rhymes yes. with bass caddy, let's say.
Yeah. Oh, talking about bass caddy? That's what he was calling me the whole time in Louisiana. You're my caddy, Dad.
I got the phone call from my 11-year-old going, "So, Papa, you didn't get an elk tag, right?" I go, "Yeah, did you get one?" He goes, "So that means you can't shoot mine, right?" I go, "Yeah."
You think?
That's what he asked. That's what the director actually said. You have to bring the tackle to your kid.
They got a limo ride to the lake.
Sweet.
Yeah. A stretch limo ride to the lake. First day.
And we got to eat breakfast in there.
First day it was a charter bus. The second day, the top 12 got a stretch Hummer limo ride to the lake with McDonald's catered to them.
How cool is that?
Wait a minute.
It was awesome.
A stretch Hummer and you're catered with McDonald's.
Right.
Yeah.
Hey, it's Louisiana.
Come on, dude.
It could have been worse. Could have been Popeyes.
Oh, yeah.
I'm not touching that one.
Oh, yeah.
Fine cuisine. from Louisiana.
All right, we're going to recap a little bit some of the stuff going on. You can go to the Shake, Rattle, and Troll website to learn about the Lake Roosevelt debacle over at the marina there. We've got the off-limits posted in a PDF form. We've got a satellite with...
Overhead
satellite, thank you, with the marina boundaries highlighted for you. As well, right next to that is the Tonto Basin Ranger District fishing policy for special events. And we've got a little article there on Dean Cruiser doing a good job representing himself and walking out of there with not guilty.
Yay, Dean.
Yeah, long and short of it, you're not going to be able to fish within 100 feet of any of the hard structure, including the walkway, the courtesy docks, the fuel docks, the slips, the tires are... Okay.
Tires are legal. That's great.
Fish the tires. A couple other things going on, Murray, while you were gone. We've got a new deal with Texas Parks and Wildlife Fisheries Department. They're going to be performing genetic testing on our largemouth bass out of 10 different areas. Be Roosevelt, Apache, Canyon, Saguaro Lakes, Pleasant, Alamo, if Alamo's got any water left in it. We're trying to figure out exactly what the Army Corps of Engineers are doing. They're talking about draining it and working on
some of the structures.
Patagonia, Havasu, and the stretch of Colorado River from the Parker Dam south to Parker.
Just below Havasu to the Parker Dam.
The biologists will go to organized tournaments and take fin clips off of the fish.
And you said these are from the Texas Fish and Wildlife?
Yeah.
They're going awesome.
Send them to Texas. Texas has had just an inordinate amount of success on Florida strain stockings. When they started, they had one lake you could catch a fish over 13 pounds.
Right.
Now they have 63.
Texas has done such an awesome job. It's just the way they do their Sharelunker program, it is awesome.
Well, we're talking to the department about getting some kind of a Sharelunker program going. What I think we'd like to do next, coming up for the 14 season, is have the BAIT, which is an acronym for Bass Angler Information Team, cards filled out and submitted to the department, obviously electronically, going back to what John and I were talking about. That's where you take the tournament director, lists how many anglers he had, how many hours you fished, how many fish over 5 pounds they caught.
That'll be pretty easy most of our tournaments, though.
At the end of the year, they can pretty much categorize the lake. Alabama did this years ago. You can go online to Alabama's DNR, and if you want to go out and catch a whole bunch of fish, you can pick that lake.
Gunnersville.
Gunnersville is up there. If you want to catch big fish, you will go to Gunnersville. Last time I looked, it was like 2.96 hours to catch a fish over 5 pounds. We've been looking at Bill Luke Bass Days on Lake Pleasant. Last year it was 13.96 hours to catch a fish over five pounds. It's good genetic or just general information for the biologist to be messing around with. And
Hunters don't have to do that. I would never share where I'm getting big bulls from, and I am never going to have a share bull program, and I am always going to consume what I shoot. Thank you.
Well, if I'm shooting it, I'm eating it too. But
think about it. If we ever get to the point where hunters are supposed to, do like a
catch and release,
a dart,
tranquilize and release.
Yeah, not happening. Sorry, that 8x8, mine.
That's going to look really good on my wall.
Yep. We're around the corner. In fact, we've passed turn the corner. Hunting season's on us. Glenn Sheldon. And you guys that are archery shooters need to know this. Glenn is a premier bow guy. He's wrenching and fixing stuff up at Lookout Mountain Outdoors.
I can't tell you how important it is to have your bow tuned.
You have to. I just picked mine up, and quite frankly, I didn't even recognize it. I mean, it is so smooth.
Is it?
Oh, yeah. Yep. So We've got to get on the stick and get that thing sighted in, and we've got to go up and run 6B this next week. So it's all good. John, in your mind, how important are optics?
Oh, the most important thing in the world. Yesterday when I was up with Dave Bruns and we were glassing for elk, early morning I knew we wanted to walk some areas and to do some stuff. Well, we were in a gray mist. I mean, it was cold. It was like in the 50s.
Rainy?
Oh, yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. And I had 10x42s. He had 15x56s. I could tell they were elk because they were white spots, a mile away. He was telling me how many points they had on them. Big difference. Huge difference. The better and if you can, we always say, if you can afford $200 for an optics package, that's the most you can scrap together, spend $800. Seriously. Because you will regret the $200 that you just happened to throw into the garbage.
How many times have we done that?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you can't scrimp on that. The better the optics, the more happy you're going to be in the long term.
I did that with my first bass boat. Going back to the comment earlier about Rich Jones and the Skeeter that Jerry Tate's running, my first experience in a bass boat was with Rich Jones, and we were coming in, and being a speed freak in my background is there, and I asked Rich, I said, just open this up one time. We're coming in, and the sun's going down, the lake's flat, and he puts it up on pad, trims it out, and just hammered that thing. I'm going, yeah. I got to get me one of those. That was Thursday night. Monday morning, I drug home my first bass boat, 17-foot nitro, 125-horse motor, and I absolutely hated that boat.
You know, we saw that boat at Havasu.
It's still out there. Yeah,
I really like the sheet metal or stainless steel splash plate you put around the back.
Yeah, man. But, I bought what I could afford, and that was a major malfunction.
Yep, absolutely.
Don't do that. And the other thing is, never, ever, ever try and glass by holding it by hand. Always, always mount it on a tripod. Got to do it that way.
You know, what I found is up at Sportsman's Warehouse, they have the little poly walking sticks with the V on the top. That works so well.
That works great, too. That's what I have.
If you're going to be sitting there somewhere, though, and glassing for one, two, and I like glassing for a couple hours at first light.
You're like a binocular freak. I've never seen anything like it.
I will sit there, cross my legs, snug it up against me, and put my hands on the top and pressure down on my head, and I'm locked and loaded. And I can sit like that for hours.
I'm a bass fisherman. I don't have that kind of patience.
It's called a modified person.
Here's the religion.
Woohoo!
This is
it. Hey, we're going to step down. Thanks some of our sponsors. If you're looking for a vehicle, Bill of Chrysler Jeep and Dodge has a private pre-Liberty sale. We'll be right back.
You get the line, I'll get the pole, babe. You get the line, I'll get the pole. We'll all go fishing in the crawdad hole. Honey, take away your mind. Crawdad, crawdad, feel you mighty fine, honey.
My honey,
crawdad, feel you mighty fine, babe.
Crawdad,
feel
you
mighty fine. 2 for
a
nickel and 3 for a dime.
Honey, sugar, babe, you're mine.
Place I'm worn out.
The preacher man says it's the end of time, and the Mississippi River, she's a gold grind.
All righty, we're back. Boy, you were almost clear to the Mississippi, weren't you? Yeah.
Yes, almost. Sir, I was.
You want to go back?
Yeah, definitely.
Good folks back there. All righty, JK, getting back on the glassing issue. What are you seeing out in the woods relative to precipitation and runoff and water hole? Because I know we've been hauling water up in 4B and 4A and 4B.
You know, you're talking a distance in 4B from northern 4B to 3A, 3C. You're talking maybe 15 miles as the crow flies at the most. And finally, 4B got some. But they hauled 50,000 gallons up there in 4B this year.
Crazy.
3A, 3C, it's fine. No problem. Because it is such a unique weather pattern front area. Geographically, right as you come up on top of the rim from Forest Lakes all the way to Heber, it's amazing the difference. And those storms, for whatever geographic reason, they hug that line of the rim and they just keep going. and Forest Lakes gets, I mean, it's so lush and it's so green. There's so much stuff up there for animals to eat.
I know, you know, traveling back and forth from Phoenix to Sholo and in that area, Forest Lakes always gets hammered.
Oh, in the winter, it's got 6 feet of snow and there's nothing in Heber. It's that remarkable of a difference.
Nuts. I'm talking with some of our biologists and weather guys. We're kind of starting to worry about 2016. The authorities are already talking about Colorado River water shortages for 2016, which is going to have a hell of an impact.
Heard that.
On all those Meade, Mojave, Havasu. But it's also going to affect Lake Pleasant.
How's that?
Well,
that's where Lake Pleasant gets their water.
Oh, it's a downflow. It's downstream from all of those.
Yeah, it comes in through the Central Arizona Project Canal. Is a agricultural-based water storage reservoir that fluctuates 100 vertical feet annually.
Jeez.
So when you're out, when you and I were out there, it was relatively stable.
Right.
But right now, you know, what you're seeing pre-fish on Wednesday, you're going to have more humps and bumps and things to bump into that weren't there
on Saturday.
Yeah. Pleasant's a navigational nightmare from week to week during the summertime as they're pulling the water out.
Who pulls the water? Oh,
CAP SRP. Pulls it.
Yeah, CAP. It's used for
irrigation.
Yeah. And, you know, I think the other thing, and Murray helped me out with this, I think the fish at Lake Pleasant, I think their brains are scrambled.
Oh, they don't know what to do.
9 months out of the year.
With the water dropping as rapidly as it does and then filling up as fast as it does, it just, these fish, they don't know where to stay. The forage is constantly moving, number one, because of the stripers and the white bass, and number two, the water levels. There's no real way to keep a good line on it.
If I were a fish and I had a favorite spot, in half the, one day it's wide open and hot air, and the next day it's 6 feet underwater, I think I'd be confused too.
Oh yeah, it's really confusing for the fish. You know, they do adapt, but you just, in trying to adapt to fish that are adapting that quick to different situations is tough on us.
You're not
going to
do it in a day.
You know, when it's
dropping, you've got to go out and pattern the fish, and you know, what Murray's talking about is like going out and pre-fishing on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, even Thursday. By the time Saturday gets around, what you already learned on Wednesday,
it's gone.
It's not going to be happening again.
No, it can't be. It was underwater and it's not now.
You know, that's the issues we've been having with Roosevelt, you know, dropping. Now that's finally stabilized a little bit. The Salt River Chain Lakes, you know, Apache, Canyon, Saguaro. They've been consistently good this summer because they've been consistent.
The SRP water levels, keeps those about 95%.
The levels are constant. Yeah. And those fish can literally pattern, you know, their lifestyle. So they can't do it in Pleasant. You know, you could pretty much, you know, Havasu's the same way. I mean, minimal fluctuation, you know, maybe 3 to 4 foot within, you know, 2-3 month period.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, stable lakes are always better fishing.
Have you heard any reports of gizzard shad being in Pleasant?
Not that I've heard.
Well, we've got...
Where's your seine net?
It's in the Fort Rear dry storage.
Got to use it.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, we've been getting reports of gizzard shad being caught by the guys looking for bait fish and the Arizona Catfishing Conservation Association. Those guys are out there throwing their nets. You know, we're trying to get one.
Yeah, guys, from now on, don't chuck it from your bucket. Make sure that you kill what you get.
Ooh, I like that.
Wow.
You're welcome.
Nice.
I like that.
That's better than mine. I can't repeat mine on the air.
No.
Yeah, rhymes with bucket. Don't
Just leave that one.
What was that again? One more time?
Don't chuck it from your bucket.
I like it.
Nice.
I like it.
I don't get it.
Okay,
I'll explain that to you on the way home, Bubba.
I'm going to explain it to you
right now.
We have a problem in this country with what we call bucket biologists, the guys that don't get it for whatever reason. They take a fish, let's say a gizzard shad that we didn't have at the time, and they think this is cool. Now, where they got them, I have no clue. But let's say they go to Lake Roosevelt and they use a gizzard shad.
As bait.
And when they get done fishing, they take their bucket and they just dump the rest of gizzard shad loose. Now we've got a major problem on Roosevelt, Gizzard Shatter taking over, the biomass is upwards of 30%, let's say. And they're too big for the apex predators, our largemouth and smallies, to eat. The only guys that are able to eat them are the bruiser-sized flatheads.
Yes.
And the big catfish. And now they're downstream into Apache. They're going to be in Canyon. They're going to be in Saguaro. And in a matter of a short time, we're going to have them down here in Tempe Town Lakes. Guaranteed.
So what you don't want to do is you don't want to take your bucket that has all kinds of little minnows, some gizzard shad. What you don't want to do is chuck it from your bucket into the lake. What
I like
you want
that.
To do is you want to take it.
Chief Cantrell will be proud of you, JK. Yeah,
thank okay,
you.
I understand now.
Okay,
see?
Get that.
I like that.
Okay, good.
All right, we've got I don't know how many different species of crawdads we have here. I mean,
they're in every body of water we have.
Yeah, but we've got as far away as the Australian red-clawed crawdad that's about the size of a Pacific rock lobster.
Those are so tasty.
I know they are, but we don't need them hanging around in our lakes necessarily.
They're not the big ones, but the others are great forage for the
yeah.
fish.
Well, that's one of the things, you know, I was thinking about you guys back in Louisiana, one of my first trips there. As I was loading the bass boat, getting ready to go do whatever I was going to do, a guy came over and he goes, "Hey, did you have lunch yet?" 3 o'clock in the afternoon. I said, "Nah, we're going to head out and go to dinner." He said, "Well, I got some right here in the bag for you." He hands me a plastic sack or a paper sack full of crawdads.
Oh, nice.
We sat there and had a cold beer and ate crawdads till I wanted to.
That was dinner.
That was, you know, I was so looking forward to that when we got there, and we missed a crawdad season by about 3 weeks.
Really?
There were no fresh crawdads.
What do you mean? Okay, back that up. Back that bus up.
What do you mean no crawdad anyway?
Crawdad stands weren't even open.
Yeah, they have a season that the locals can actually go out and trap crawdads.
Sure.
And boil them and sell them out of their stands. They've got little stands. I mean, every block. You know, fresh crawdads.
And there were none when you guys were there?
None.
No. You missed it by 2 weeks?
Crawdads, catfish, and barbecue. In a Baptist church every half mile.
Oh, I knew the Baptist church was there.
Yeah,
I wasn't worried about that.
Yeah, praise the Lord and pass the bait. Amen.
Exactly. Kind of like going to Mesa.
You know what? I have church. No problem with that, but I sure wish I could have found somebody who would cook crawdads like that. That would be the one time I would love to go through just to gain some ideas on how to, because we've got enough crawdads here to do it. I mean, ours are a lot smaller, right? Aren't they? Ours are smaller, right?
You got to take the small ones out, but, you know, 3-inch, 4-inch crawdads.
Yeah, you got 4-inch crawdads
everywhere.
Running around Lake Pleasant.
That's what I've cooked up in the past.
Yeah, you start looking at Long Lake and some of the other stuff. I mean, we have crawdads.
Mm-hmm. I still have a real serious issue with anything that's coming out of tea-colored water. You know, you got oil derricks that are booming all along in the lake, and you're going to eat something that came out of that?
Uh-huh.
I don't know.
Give me the crawdads.
I ain't saying, I'm just saying.
All right.
Think about it.
I get it.
Okay.
I don't want to think about it.
That's why I like trout.
You know, you get back to some of those areas, roadkill in Arkansas.
Yeah.
They call it supper.
Mm-hmm. Been there, done that.
Yeah.
I've had more than two deer already that have come under my wheels and my rigs.
Nice.
And they became tenderloin dinners. Yeah, there's nothing wrong with that.
Good ground.
Do you have a permit for that?
Don't need one. Didn't need one.
If it takes out your grill, you can keep it?
Yeah, if it takes out your grill, it goes on your grill.
Okay, nice.
All right.
All righty, we're going to step down. When we come back, we're going to change gears and go to downtown Payson with our master rod builder, James Guggenhauer from Rim Country Custom Rods.
Crawdad, feel you mighty fine, honey.
My honey.
Crawdad, feel you mighty fine, babe. Crawdad, feel you mighty fine, weed. Willie again.
All righty, hey, that's some good advice right there.
Damn good advice.
Yeah.
Hey, we're going to visit with our buddy James Guggenhauer in downtown Payson. Hey, James, is it wet up there today?
Yes.
Yes, it is. We woke up this morning and had a great drizzle going on out there.
Nice.
66 degrees this morning.
Oh.
Nice overcast and cool.
No, that's beautiful.
The other thing I want to know,
I'm going to ask this. I really don't want to know the answer to this, but are you hearing Elk Bugle from your back porch?
Not yet.
You know what I hear And it seems like this time of year, just before the bulls start to bugling, it's almost like the cows get more active. Just before daylight, you can really hear them mewing out there.
Nice.
Yeah, they're talking. The boys are coming. The boys are coming. The boys are coming.
Yeah.
And I hear that morning now.
All righty. Well, hey, I want to tell you, we're in the presence of greatness. Taj White is here, youth champion from Arizona. Taught the guys in Alabama how to catch a 5-fish limit, man. He just did an outstanding job.
Louisiana.
Congrats.
Great. I'm listening through your website. Good show.
All righty. What's on the fishing agenda today for the Mother Lake?
Hey, Roosevelt Lake, it dropped another 1% this past week. We currently stand at 44% full. It's been slowing down a little bit like that, but the good news is the Salt River continues to flow pretty heavily. This morning it's flowing at just over 350 cubic feet per second, which is about normal for this time of year. Now, the flow in the Tonneau Creek is way down. For whatever reason, we're getting more inflow from the salt end than the Tonneau end. The water temperature of the lake is in the mid-80s in the morning, increasing to the high 80s in the afternoon. Now, a lot of guys that fish Roosevelt always say that, you know, it fishes like two different lakes, and we really had that this week. The Salt River end is producing much better fishing than the Tonneau end, and that's probably because of that big inflow of water. On the salt end, there's a very clear water line where the clear water and the stained water meet, and you can see several boats fishing that water line. Whereas on the Tonneau end, with the water not flowing in, it's just clear down at that end, crystal clear on the Tonneau end, and pretty stained, actually, up on the salt end, and that's being reflected in the fishing this week.
JK, we call that a mud line.
I figured that.
Okay. Yeah.
All right. Thank you.
Overall, the bass fishing was called fair this past week on Roosevelt, and a lot of guys with that dirtier water, they're going to a jig, and they're using a flipping technique with a dark color jig. The second most common thing that was reported was a drop shot. But what was different this week is guys are going more to darker colored worms. The last couple of weeks has been more translucent type baits, like a Morning Dawn Robo Worm bait. But now it's more of the camos and the purples and the brown colored baits.
That would be the tequila mutilator. Yeah.
I mean the margarita mutilator?
Yeah. He's on it.
And then the third thing that was reported was a Carolina rig. You know, this summertime patterns, guys like the Carolina rigs, and they're using larger curly tail worms for that. Now, the other thing that's going on, we talked about this a week or so ago, Don, is that, you know, there's still a gradual change going on at Roosevelt. We are changing from a summer pattern to what is being called a late summer, early fall pattern. And, you know, every day you can kind of feel it happening. It seems like the fish are getting more suspended. They're kind of getting ready to move to that fall fishing. So I can't wait for that because that's my favorite time of year to go fishing.
Top water.
Yeah, when you can spend the whole day out there and have a lot of fun in the fall. So if that's your listener's favorite time to be out on the water, I'm telling everybody to get ready because we may be a month or so away, but it's definitely changing.
I'll tell you what, James, every time I go on the water, it's my favorite time of year.
Well, I agree with that. But for, you know, for me, I like fishing in the summertime for the early morning bite. But after it gets to be about 10 o'clock, I'm thinking more about staying cool than I am thinking about fishing.
Yeah, you got it.
Absolutely.
Yep. Start early, leave early.
All right. Hey, now the crappie bite, also called fair, but I got a little more specifics this week on the crappie for those who like to come up because, and once again, this might be a change that things are changing a little bit in the lake. We're starting to see smaller schools of crappie in the brush in 25 to 30 feet of water. That's typically a summer type deal, but we're I don't know why. For whatever reason, we're just starting to see that in good numbers now. A lot of patience is going to be required, and you might have to catch a couple of crappie from one bush and then move to another bush and let that first spot kind of settle down a little bit. And ideally, if you've got 4 to 5 spots like that, you could just rotate between them. The bait that's being recommended is a 2-inch grub tail on a 1/16 or a 1-ounce, 1/8 ounce jig head. Now, the line you got to use is a 4 to 6 pound line, and a ultralight rod that is extremely sensitive is almost a must, so you can literally feel your jig going through that brush down there. That's the most success. But I actually got numbers where guys were catching between 5 and 10 this week, and that's a big tick up for what we've been getting the last couple of weeks.
Yeah, sure has been. Wow.
Yeah. The good news for fishing up here continues to be the rim lakes. This has to be one of the best years for the rim lakes. I don't know if it has to do with more monsoon rain up there or the temperatures change or whatever, but just week after week when I call the fishermen up on the rim, they're telling me that it is excellent and very steady. We were talking about consistent water levels and consistent habitat of the fish. That seems to be what's going on up there. One of the changes that's occurred the last couple of weeks is the cicadas seem to be a very popular bait this time of year. We have cicadas that are out, and when they start buzzing on the waters up there, the trout love to go grab those things.
Yeah, I've noticed that. I got a bunch of them buzzing on the front porch, boy. They'll make you crazy, that buzzing noise.
Especially with the moist air, they just keep going nuts.
You right.
Pick them off with a BB gun.
Yep.
These guys are telling me that when they land on the water up there, they don't last 2 minutes.
Bam. Game over.
Hey, also, power baits, some small grubs, and dry flies are working up there. So, good time to be up in rim country. Weather's just perfect. Invite everybody to come up and try some fishing.
What is the latest on our buddy Clifford Perch?
Clifford, it looks like that he did not make the Bassmaster Classic. On Friday, they had him listed as 28th, and it looked like he and John Murray were both going to make the cut. However, yesterday's update, they had him tied for 29th, which would put him one place out of making the Bassmaster Classic.
Ouch.
Ooh. But
the good news is John Murray will make it, and it looks like Josh Bertrand and Clifford and D. Rojos, all from Arizona, will not make the Classic.
Oh, no.
And Clifford is just a heartbreaker in his
life. Oh, yeah. Man, he's been fishing his little heart out this year.
Yeah.
Well, it's good to see Murray in there. What is Clifford going to make it to the Open then?
Yes, he's definitely planning on fishing. We talked to him earlier. He's a two-time champion.
I know.
Yes,
yeah, there goes the neighborhood.
So, he'll be heading back and going up that way. There's also a Bassmaster All-Star tournament, and depending on how many votes he gets in the All-Star for Bassmaster, and guys can check that out on the Bassmaster website, you can vote for your favorite All-Stars, he may be fishing that tournament as well.
Very cool. Well, we've got Bill Rooley and Andy Manal and a bunch of local guys up slugging it out on the Open, but I'll tell you what, they've got, correct me if I'm wrong, there's some big sticks up there they got to look out
for. Absolutely. You know, I was really shooting to go for it this year, but just with boat issues and everything, I think it kind of took me out of it. So.
Wow.
Yeah, you're right, Don. I listened to Andy call in there last week or so, and, you know, that tournament just keeps getting bigger and bigger, bigger name guys fish that thing, and it's really a grind.
Well, quite frankly, the biggest names in the business are going to be there. You know, rhymes with Rick Klun for one of them.
Right.
You know, another guy to look out for is Mike Volstead.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Mike's like a rattlesnake in the bush.
Yeah, he always does well up there. And so, it's always a fun time of year. And the other thing, you know, the U.S. Open, to me, always means, like, the end of summertime fishing. After that tournament's over, the heat's gone, and we can start looking forward to cooling down a little bit.
Yeah, I think you're right. But, you know, it's going to be interesting how that plays out. There's so many different patterns up there. Like, you know, and meat is so huge, John. There's going to be, you know, about six different environments on that lake.
Yeah,
you know,
good.
One area is going to be doing worms, and the next area won't want worms. They want top water and crankbaits in the middle. And holy cow, it's going to be interesting to see how this plays out.
Yep.
All righty, anything else to add?
Nope. Have a great week, and I'll talk to you all next week.
Yeah, man.
Enjoy the weather.
Yep. Check out Rim Country Custom Rods. Not a better rod builder in the country, James Guggenhauer. I'm Don McDowell with
Murray White.
Taj White.
John Colazar.
All righty, when we come back, we're going to get this thing wrapped up and probably go wipe the boat down, I'm thinking. Nice.
Yeah,
go jump in the pool.
With a grin on my face and a great contact high, I'll never smoke weed really again. My party's all over before it began. You can pour me some old whiskey river, my friend. I'll never smoke weed with Willie. In the fetal position, with drool on our chin, we broke down and smoked weed with Willie again.
Steve Campbell here with Daiichi Hooks, TTI Blakemore. I listen to Shake, Rattle, and Troll in Alabama.
Man, it's hot in here. When your home air conditioner breaks down, wouldn't you like to have a friend in the business? Well, now you do. Bill Ruley at Ruley Air is your go-to guy for home heating and cooling service and repairs. Ruley Air will give you the prompt, courteous service and discounted pricing you would expect from a friend. Bill Ruley at Ruley Air, 602-315-8545. Ruley Air, your friend in the business, 602-315-8545. Ruley Air, 602-315-8545.
When fishing for success, why fish with an imitator? Fish with the best, Rico. I'm Chris Ritchie, the U.S. Open AAA champion, and that is my recipe for success. LobinaLures.com.
Listen up and listen good, Pilgrim. The next step in soft plastics evolution has been taken. Hyper technology. 21st century hyper technology has turned that old do-nothing baits into hyperactive lures that catch more and better fish with increased water dispersion, vibration, and action. Yaha. Made in America, which you know I love, kid. Lake Fork tackle lures are pro-proven and provide the highest quality and innovation on the market today. Whether you're a touring pro or a recreational angler, give yourself the edge with the LFT Hyper series of soft plastics from freaks to whacking worms. Pick your baits, pick your colors, terminal tackle rods and reels with the latest high performance lines on the market. Lake Fork Tackle Trophy. Shop online at LFTLures.com.
Celebrity voice impersonated.
Yeah, dude's been dead for like 30 years.
Do you take your hair for granted? Are you tired of windblown, tangled hair? How do you want to show up to your next event? Your hair does more than cover your scalp. It's your statement. I'm Susan Hoffman, Hair Design by Susan, 480-861-4656. I'm your source from basic haircuts to color, highlights, dimensional hair coloring, and perming. I'm located in Scottsdale, and when you call me, you're not talking to a receptionist. I'm Susan Hoffman, 480-861-4656. Thanks.
This segment of Shake, Rattle, and Troll is brought to you by True Turn Hooks, the hook that strikes back.
All righty. Hey, thanks for joining us today. We're going to get this thing wrapped up. If you want to know about what's happening on Roosevelt fishing boundaries inside the marina, it's on ShakeRattleAndTroll.com, right in the middle of the page. We've got the map. We've got the Tonto Basin tournament rules. And all the information you need about that. Don't get caught with your live well open, I guess. I'll leave it to go with that. I want to thank Murray, a couple reasons. You're a good dad, outstanding public servant, so to speak, with all the youth stuff that you do for the Phoenix Bassmasters Youth Organization. I think Taj here is going to achieve his goals. You're a good man. And a couple years from now, don't forget to thank your dad. And when he's old and gray, he's already passed the old gray part. You're like me. You bypass the gray and went straight to white.
Right. Yeah, no. Don,
just take you fishing, man.
Don, thank you. I appreciate that. I do my best. My son's, number one in my life, and whatever it takes.
It's all about the kids.
It is, and taking over the youth club when I did was just such a blessing for me.
It's a lot of work.
It's a lot of work. My wife helps me out on it, but when I took over, it's incredible seeing these kids and watching them grow.
Yeah.
We've been part of the club since Taj was in the younger age group. I think he was 9 when we started. So we're, going 3 years, and I've watched kids go from, the younger age group to the older age group. And just watching them grow up in front of me is awesome.
We've seen a lot of things with kids here. We've got a lot of talent coming out of Arizona. Take it back to the racing days. We've got quite a few guys running NASCAR from here, mm-hmm. and sprint cars, midgets, all that kind of stuff. And when a guy's talented like Taj is, you get to a certain level, it's time to step out of your comfort zone and absolutely go for it.
Absolutely.
And that's exactly what I did.
Well, you got a couple years left, and you're going to be faced with some real uncomfortable decisions. And we've seen it here with tournament anglers. We've got some really awesome local sticks here.
Right.
And they don't have whatever it takes, whether it's drive or ability or whatever it is, to take that next step.
Takes that next step.
You want to be a big fish in a small pond, stay here.
Right.
Yeah, don't go for it.
No. This year, or this coming season, I do plan on hitting the Central Opens.
Yeah.
I was really shooting for the U.S. Open this year, but like I said, with boat and vehicle issues at this point, it's just kind of taking me out of that game. I'm just going to start putting my money away for the Central Opens.
Yeah, we've got some stuff coming to Arizona the next couple of years. So.
Yes. So. Uh-oh, here we go, playing with toys again.
Lord help me.
I opened my gift from
Happy
Don and
birthday,
Jan,
Jake.
And
I
it's Jailhouse Johnny Raccoon
I
playing
did
Jailhouse Rock.
Not bring him back from Louisiana, so.
Come on, you did.
That's funny. Wow. That's hilarious.
That is awesome.
What has happened to our show? Anyway, JK, if you got anything to add on behalf of the Bullet Side of Life?
No, actually, we're looking. I'm sorry, I can't. Don't stab him. Don't. I don't know how to stop it. Here, stop it. Okay, thank you.
Back to you, JK.
Well, that
it
was
could
embarrassing.
Be coon hunting right here in the studio.
No, we're all looking forward, obviously. Archery season started for deer already.
Dove season's around the corner.
Yep. Yeehaw. I will spend an inordinate amount of time over the next 3 weeks up in the mountains getting ready for my elk hunt with my sons. And so
nice.
Psyched about it, looking forward to it. And I know that weather-wise, it's been fabulous. If we had this weather last year, my archery deer hunt in 3C might have been a lot more productive.
Yeah, I'm really concerned about the mother lake. We're 44%.
It's not
how far is it going to go?
We've seen it there before. We've seen it lower than that before.
Yeah, I understand that. But, the lower it gets, the more concentration of problems we're going to have.
Yeah, it does.
Maybe we're going to have a wet winter. That's the only thing I can hope for.
I don't
for.
Know. The weather guys at NOAA aren't thinking so.
Really?
I mean, we got some weird weather stuff going on. Just watching the currents offshore, is a pretty good indication. We should have, right now, give you an idea, we should have bluefin inside 80 miles.
Right.
60, 80 miles. They're gone. And, I don't know what in the heck's going on. And some of the predictions, talking to the conservation guys, true conservationists, and looking at the biology guys, looking at the weather guys, and we've got, you know, I'm not a doomsdayer necessarily, but we've got some issues coming. We already have had.
Yeah.
And we've got low water concentrations on the Salt River, golden alga. We got gizzard shad. We got this, you know, it's like, man.
You know, I can't remember really. I think it was back in the 90s was the last time we had really good wet winters. I mean, really saturated well. We haven't had it.
It was.
And that's, you know, that's 14, 15 years now.
Well, SRP, you know, said it going into 2013, we've got the same global atmospheric conditions as we had in 2002, which was the driest year on record.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're just kind of holding our breath, hoping the golden alga didn't blow up and create some problems. But anyway. It is what it is. You know, you can't change it.
Wolf commentary period's ending soon. Make sure everybody puts in their comments.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
If you don't, shame on you.
Yeah, that wolf commentary period's been extended from September 11 to September 19th, I believe.
Yes. When they gave it an extra 8 days.
Yeah. Are you going to be up at the commission meeting in Pine Top on the 7th?
That's my thought. You know, it's the last week, and then I can scout, and I figure I have to be up there anyhow. I'd love to say hi to the commissioners and see what they're going to do, and to see if we have a wolf management plan that's probably that they can at least submit for proposal.
It should have the MOU and draft plan by then, I would think.
Yeah, I would too.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for the birthday gift. Thank you, Jan. You are awesome.
Happy birthday. Woo-hoo.
Your bride is special.
Squeeze my foot. All right.
Squeeze my foot, and it plays Jailhouse Rock.
All right, champ, anything you want to add? What advice do you have for guys your age that want to go fishing?
Just follow your dreams, keep your goal in your head, and just try your best and achieve it, and that's all there is to it.
Stated. All right.
Perfect advice.
If there's a guy out there that wants to fish, doesn't know how to fish, what can he do?
Call you.
Yep. you know, we have the Juniors Club. They could join that. We have other clubs out in Arizona. They could join those.
You can check out Phoenix Junior Bassmasters at phoenixjuniorbassmastersallspelledout.com. Not the all spelled out part, but...
And they'll throw my parents into a tizzy.
Right. And then you can also check us out on Facebook at Phoenix Junior Bassmasters. And that's just JR Phoenix.
How many guys, kids do you have?
45.
We've got about 45 kids in the club right now. I just talked to a young man last night that is wanting to join, and they have a boat, so he's more than welcome.
Glad I have a boat.
Yeah, absolutely.
A pirate boat.
Yep.
Don't go to that dance again.
So. Yeah, speaking of boats, I want to throw a big thank you out to Amp Upholstery. They did a custom fit boat cover for the hot rod.
Nice. That's, you know, they did my carpeting, and oh my God, my boat looks beautiful. That's the next thing.
Did you get the new
I got the padding on the front deck.
I got it on the front deck. Didn't put it on the back deck.
Nope.
Nice.
Nope.
They do an outstanding job.
They do.
We've got some stuff up on the website about Amp, and yeah, I'll tell you, it's so nice to have a boat cover that fits.
Yeah, I want one that fits. I've got a couple that just, I mean, they cover it, and it does serve its purpose.
I had my custom fit went away with the UV and got trashed, and I got the one size fits a Greyhound bus from Walmart for $99.
You don't want to travel with that one.
No, it's like having a parachute behind your truck.
Yeah. Oof. If it's not form-fitting, why bother?
Yeah.
All right, guys. Hey, check out SRT on iTunes. Click on a podcast. You can also see Don McDowell on that. And go ahead and click on that, and you'll be able to listen to these casts all the time.
Wow. Well said. What he said. Hey, I'm Don McDowell.
John Colazar.
Taj White.
And Murray White.
Guys, thanks for coming down. Hey,
thanks for having us, Don.
Salute a soldier. Pick your kids fish and hug your bass boat, and we're out of here.
See ya.
We'll see you next week. Well, some like to rock, some like to roll. Me and the boys like to shake, rattle and troll. Shake.